In the name of the living God, who was, who is, and is to come. Amen. So I'm into quilting. I started dabbling in it about 8 or 10 years ago when my friend in Holsomopolis had her first baby boy. I made a quilt for her and dabbled a little bit here and there and was sort of enamored of it, but not terribly, until my own grandchildren started to arrive in the world. And then I started back into it rather completely. I'm self-taught, which does cause you to question the instructor a wee bit. Because I am now taking an actual class. I'm learning how to do free motion quilting, which I'm not sure I'm going to pass this class. But one of the things I am learning is all of the things I have done wrong all these years. But the good news is the quilts I've made have managed to stay together, and that's a good thing. So you wonder maybe why I'm thinking about quilts today. Well, they're very much on my mind, and they have been ever since I started reading the lessons for today. Quilts are fascinating. And no matter where you go in the country, you'll find a history is so associated with them. Hawaii, Iowa, Massachusetts, every region has its own set of traditions around the quilting wonder. Matter of fact, it's an old art form, and it was born out of scarcity. So scarcity becomes abundance in quilting, because those early quilters, the pioneer women who sort of honed this craft, found fabrics of any kind that they could. And they stitch them together to make something warm and comforting for their families. It's absolutely amazing. Scarcity into abundance. That's what quilting is all about. And it's the kind of thing that you can do in prayerful solitude or in raucous community. And still, it happens to become this amazing, wonderful gift of nurture and love and power of history. Well, so I was in my class this last week. And my professor, whose name is Billy, and she's kind of cantankerous, and I love her, she started talking about having a single line quilting motif and how important that is for your quilt. Now, for those of you who maybe don't know about quilting, I'll give you a little tutorial. So there's such a thing as a sandwich, a quilt sandwich. So the top layer is all those pieces that you've put together in various forms, colors. I mean, the sky's the limit for what you can do. The bottom piece is just one plain piece of fabric, and in between is the warm goodness. And those three layers have to be combined and held. And that's where the quilting stitches come in. So my instructor was saying that having a single line quilting motif is the strongest way to bind your, to make your quilts. Not always easy to do. But she said one of the most popular motifs for that single line quilting is the vine. Ha! See the connection? The vine! The vine is what is used over and over again to create these amazing gifts. And the vine is what we're hearing about today. What we're hearing about today is how do we become disciples of Christ? That's the big question. How do we abide in God, and how does God abide in us? That's what we're talking about today. So how do we do that? Well, let's follow the vine line. And if we go to our first reading, we have this wonderful story of a eunuch reading the suffering servant. Right? He's reading Isaiah. And the Holy Spirit, an angel, says to Philip, go talk to the eunuch. So Philip does. And the Spirit says, get in there and talk with him. Work with him. And so Philip does. And in so doing, opens the eunuch's mind to the scriptures. Now, you've heard that scenario before. The road to Emmaus, when Jesus opens the minds of the people he meets to understand the scriptures. And so the eunuch is so excited that as they pass by water, the eunuch is all about baptism. Now, notice it's not Philip who says, let's baptize you. It's the eunuch. Right, in his excitement of being converted, he wants to be in the family. Let's do it. And so they do. And so they do. And so that wonderful line, that wonderful, wonderful history of Isaiah and Philip and the eunuch, that is all the same line. See, here's what's fascinating. The same spirit that moved Philip to do what he did today is the exact same spirit that we heard on Jesus' baptism, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And the same Spirit that chased Jesus out into the wilderness for 40 days. It is the same Spirit who put into the mouth of Jesus on the cross the opening lines of the psalm we read today, which we didn't read. We didn't read the opening line. Do you know what the opening line of today's psalm is? My God, why have you forsaken me? The psalm then moves from that point into this wonderful, wonderful part that we have here. And it ends with, "They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done." And that's you and me. That self-same Spirit that moves throughout all time is here now today. These are stunning motifs and wonderful images that help us to understand our God in new and powerful ways. Now, we're talking about how do we become disciples, because Jesus is saying, go out and be disciples. And someone suggested that probably the way to know if you are doing God's work is to notice the fruits of the Spirit. Things like love, patience, kindness, all those extraordinary gifts of the Holy Spirit. If we're feeling those, chances are we are doing the work of a disciple. And there's this wonderful quote that I found that I don't know who said it, but I love it. And it is that the fruits of the Spirit do not make disciples. The fruits of the Spirit reveal disciples, which is a lovely image, I think. And so that idea of the Trinity of fabrics coming together and being bound by this single vine, this thread that goes all the way through time, from the very beginning of creation, all the way down to you and me, calling us to bring the message, to bring the idea of Christ into those yet unborn. It is a powerful and beautiful possibility, and so much fun. If you think about how creative it is to find ways to share love, to share nurture, to share the kindness that we have been given. So, I'm a novice quilter, no question about it. And I'm a novice Christian too. We all are. We're learning all the time how to do the work that we have been given to do. How to change the world in which we live. How to find kindness where adversity seems to want to reign supreme. How do we create a nurturing, wonderful gift that will surround in love and patience and connect to all that is real and holy and true? That's the challenge. That's the joy. And that's the delight of what it means to be alive today. Amen. Amen.